Okay, so in last lecture we saw how the formula for arc length calculation is given a parameterization, and we did one example. Now in this short lecture what we will do is we'll look at two things. One, what's the intuitive reasoning behind the formula? We're not going to go very detailed proof of it because the intuitive reasoning is enough for you to see it. And that is this. So imagine this is your curve. Let's just imagine it's in 2D. And so let's say basically your R of T is X of T, Y of T, and T is between two values A and B. And let's say the value corresponding to A, T equal to A value is this. So it gives you, let's say, X of A, the X of A comma Y of A, and then this is the one corresponding to B. T equal to B, similarly, the XY coordinates are X of B, Y of B. Now, so you have to find the length of this curve, right? So this is not a straight line, so this is not easy to do, or it's not a series of straight lines. But what we can do is we can use the series of straight lines idea to approximate the length of this curve. So let me get a different color marker to show you what I'm talking about. What you could do is you could say, you could take a few intervals in between, let's say like this, and you can, instead of looking at the curve from this point to this point, treat it as a straight line. Treat it as a straight line. Treat it as a straight line, straight line, straight line. Right? And you just take the lengths of these straight lines, add them up, it will give you an approximation to the length of the curve. Will it be exactly the length of the curve? Obviously not. Okay, but it will be an approximation. So, these are two common principles in math, and you have seen this with the Riemann sums when we do integrals for areas under curve. The two principles, two principles when you cannot find something accurately, is one is to look for an approximation. Second, once you've found an approximation, see if you can find an approximating procedure that can be refined. Suppose I want a better approximation than this, what would I do? As you might guess, as you've seen Riemann sums, you take more points. So instead of just taking these few points, let's draw the curve again. And then instead of taking only this, you know, earlier we had only these points, let's take a few more points in between, take a whole bunch of points. Now, the difference between these straight lines and the curve part is less in each segment. And some of them are pretty good actually, right? Like this. So then you add up the lengths of these things. The thing is, what you do here, if you think about it, if this is your t equal to, let's say, t1, and this is t equal to t2 point, what you are doing, you are adding up, you're looking at r of t2 minus r of t1. This gives you a vector, okay? Because r of t2 is a xy pair, r of t1 is an xy pair. You subtract the xy pairs, it'll give you a vector, and then you're looking at its length, right? So you can think of it is what is going to be. This is going to be the, so let's think of it, t2 minus t1 is delta t, a small difference in time. You have a little stopwatch, and every few seconds, you stop the stopwatch, measure the position, and draw the straight line distance between the last point and the second time you stop the stopwatch. So this is going to equal x of t2 minus x of t1 squared plus y of t2 minus y of t1 squared, and then the square root to get the length of that, right? So essentially what you're doing is, you can think of it, x of t2 minus x of t1 is the change in x. So this, think of it now, this is equal to the square root of delta x squared plus delta y squared, right? For the delta t small time change, you look at the small change in x, small change in y, square them, add them using Pythagoras' theorem. Okay, so that'll give you an approximation. Now, using the same idea as we did in Riemann sums, you take the limit of this. The limit, what's the limit? The limit of this, that you make this segment smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. Okay? What happens is when you make this, the delta t will go towards what is called dt, the infinitesimal change in time step, which is going to bring you to the idea of the derivative. So that's why this eventually ends up going towards as delta t goes to dt, we end up getting the length of the derivative, right? The length of the derivative vector. The length of the derivative vector at each place. And then what you do, you want to add it up, you integrate it. You integrate it over all values of the t, dt. So it's exactly the same as the Riemann idea of the sum applied to arc length. And so that's the intuitive reasoning why this formula indeed gives you the length. I gave you the intuitive reasoning in 2D, but same applies in 3D, 4D, however many dimensions you have the space curve. Okay, so that was one thing we wanted to do in this lecture. Let's talk about another point, which is that the length that you calculate of a curve should not depend on parameterization, right? We have already seen in class that how same curve can be parameterized so many different ways, hundreds and hundreds of ways. You can change the variable, you can change the, and depending on the change in the variable, you change the time interval. So a question arises, if I change the parameterization, because my integral depends on the parameterization, doesn't that change the value of, doesn't it change the length of the curve? And turns out, no, it doesn't. Let's give you an example. So the last example we saw, we had the helix, or the spiral, the circular spiral. We had r of t was cosine t, sine t, t, t between 0 and 2 pi. And we found that the length of this thing, when we did the integral, was 2 pi square root of 2. Okay? What are we going to do? We're going to take the same physical curve, parameterize it a different way, and calculate the length with that other parameterization and find out that we actually it doesn't make a difference. Here is the other parameterization. Here is another parameterization. I shouldn't say the other, because there are many other parameterizations you can make of this curve. Let's take cosine of 2t. Sine of 2t. And 2t. Now obviously with this t in there, to make the exact same image which I had, which was like, right, this just this one loop of the helix, you will take the t's between, because the time moves fast here, because each t gets multiplied by 2, you only need to go from 0 to pi to trace out exactly this thing. If we go 0 to 2 pi, it will trace out two actual circles. That's not what we want exactly the same curve. So we have a different parameterization. But then, let's do the calculations now. Same calculations, and this will be good practice for us to see also how these things work. The derivative vector, right, the tangent vector is negative 2 sine of 2t. The derivative of sine 2t is 2 cosine of 2t. And the derivative of this is 2. So then the length of this r prime of t is 4 sine square of 2t plus 4 cosine square of 2t plus 4, all square rooted. And this comes out to be what? 4, factor out the 4 from here, you get sine square plus cosine square of the same angle. So you get 1. So you factor 4. 4 plus 4 is 8. You get the square root of 8, which is 2 square root of 2. Okay? That's your length of the tangent vector or the derivative vector. Now what we do, we integrate that guy. We integrate this thing from, what is our parameterization limits? From 0 to pi. So we integrate this from 0 to pi. So you get the integral from 0 to pi of 2 square root of t dt, and indeed this does equal 2 pi square root of 2. So we got the same length that we got last time, even though we had a different parameterization with different time values. Okay, so this is important. So, you know, I'm not going to go through again technical proof of this. I'm going to give you intuitive view. Let's just write this down. It's something to keep in mind. Note, arc length formula gives same answer for different parameterizations of the same curve. Okay? This is something to keep in mind. Now, what's the intuitive reasoning behind this? The intuitive reasoning behind this is, when you change the parameterization, think of it physically. Changing a parameterization, what does it do? Like we did here, every t became a 2t, or t became a t square. It changes the speed. Think of it like the insect is walking on this curve. A different parameterization, eventually same curve is being traced out, but it's being walked at a different speed. Maybe one is like this way, the other one is like this way. The other one might be at a non-uniform speed. It might be slow, then this way. According to this speed, we also mentioned in class that the tangent vector changes its length according to the parameterization, right? So, because the tangent vector is smaller or longer, depending on if it's faster or slower, so even though you have a longer tangent vector, but then you integrate it over a smaller interval, right? So then, at the end of the day, you get the same answer, okay? And that's something important to keep in mind, that when you have, when you're given a curve, because often in real life what will happen is that nobody's going to give you a parameterization. Somebody's going to actually, you'll see a curve out there, like it's a metal rod that's twisted in a certain way, and you want to find its length because you want to find the amount of something that needed to cover it. So you will, what do you do? You will parameterize that curve. Then you shouldn't worry, wait a minute, how should I parameterize it? Is it going to affect my arc length? No, it's not going to affect it, right? So go ahead, parameterize it however you want to parameterize it, and then compute this thing. Okay, so that finishes this little lecture, and then we'll continue some more things about arc length in the next lecture.